And my text is found in the book of Acts, chapter number 28, if you will turn there. Amen. Chapter 28 of the book of Acts. We're going to read the first 5 verses out of that chapter. Acts chapter number 28. Began reading it verse number 1. Look with me, it said, "And when they were escaped, then they knew that the island was called Melita. And the barbarous people showed us no little kindness, for they kindled a fire and received us every one because of the present rain and because of the cold." How many of you know it can get real cold when it's raining? We've experienced that around here this last week, that it was cold, it was rainy, they gave us such hospitality, they kindled a fire to help us out. Verse number 3 said, "And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, there came a viper out of the heat and fastened on his hand. And when the barbarians saw the venomous beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, 'No doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he hath escaped the sea, yet vengeance suffereth not to live.'" The Bible said, "And he shook off the beast into the fire and felt no harm." And I want to preach to you tonight about teamwork in fire building. Amen. Teamwork in fire building. Hallelujah. It takes teamwork in every aspect of the church. But oh, my friend, it's a cold, cold world out there. And when people walk through this door to come into a church service here, they need to feel a warm, hallelujah, rip-roaring fire of God that's in this place. They need to feel something that warms the cold that the world is out there. And it required in the New Testament, it required, amen, some teamwork, working together, amen, in building the fire. Let's pray together. Sweet God, we love you. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, mighty God. How good you are, God. I know that you're going to help us, God. I know, Lord, that what you have talked to my heart about, you are ready and able and willing and desirous, God, to talk to everyone that's a part of Victory Tabernacle tonight about it. I trust you to do that, God. I believe you, Lord. Not only anoint the words that I say, but anoint the hearts to receive it, God, for the glory and the honor of the Lord, in the name of Jesus. And everybody said amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Amen. Fire is a predominant theme of the Scriptures. You only have to be a casual reader of the Bible before you will soon figure out that the Almighty God, hallelujah, represents himself, his kingdom, his work, and the action of when the people come together to worship and honor him, he associates that with fire building. There are literally hundreds of verses, if you would care to look in an exhaustive concordance, that it just in the book of Exodus and Leviticus and Deuteronomy alone, you'll get overdosed with verses that have to do with instruction concerning fire, concerning the connection of the people and their worship and their sacrifices and the things that they are to come and to bring to offer unto God. He is not interested in us bringing cold, wet things to the house of the Lord. He's interested in His fire being there. He put it this way. He said, your God is a consuming fire. You want to know about God, understand that He is a fire, a consuming fire. When the nation of Israel set out from Egyptian bondage to make that long trek that was going to take them 40 years in the journey to make it to the promised land, guess what God did? He said, I'm going to show you how faithful I am and how connected to fire that I am. Every night out there on the desert, you're not going to have electric blankets. You're not even going to be able to have fireplaces. There'll be no heaters inside of your tent for you to turn on. It's desert. You can't burn cactuses and expect to stay warm, because cactus is full of water and it just won't burn. And so the only way that you're going to be able to have heat and warmth is your God is going to become a pillar of fire by night. Every night when the rest of the nations are out there having to try to figure out how to stay warm on the freezing desert in the wintertime, I'm going to bring a portable heater, and I'm going to light a blaze that's so glorious up in the sky that everybody is going to be reminded that pillar of fire is my God. He's alive. He's on fire. He's warm. Hallelujah. The closer I get to Him, the warmer I become. The farther I get away from Him, the colder I become. And so He gave them these visual illustrations of fire and what God was unto them. There was, as you know in the Scripture, a challenge that was made on Mount Carmel by the prophet of God, bold and full of God's anointing. Elijah looked at the situation and said, old backslidden Ahab and wicked Jezebel have convinced all of these people that our God is no stronger than their gods, that the gods of Baal are just as real. And so Elijah stood there and issued the challenge unto them. He said, the God that answers by fire, we're going to let Him be God. We're going to settle it for once and for all. If your gods that you're serving have got any power within them, they've got some fire. And if there's any fire in their belly, we want to see it. And we're going to issue a challenge here, and we're going to fix up a sacrifice upon the top of this mountain. Whatever God answers by fire, we know He's the true and the living God. And so it was that Elijah gave them their chance and their opportunity. And he said, you go first, please, O prophets of Baal. Have your fun, amen, at trying to get your God to see if He can muster up a little fire from somewhere. Just some way that you can get a little bit of fire. Even try the magnifying glass, maybe, with the sun, and see if there's a way you can get whatever. Pray, do whatever you can do. And Elijah had a blast just making fun of them. Amen. They prayed. Oh, they had a prayer meeting going. They were praying. They were chanting. They finally started getting desperate. They started trying to cut themselves to get the attention of their God and dancing around that altar, crying out, Oh Baal, send down some fire. Send down some fire. And Elijah, oh hallelujah, Elijah was sitting over there just making fun of him. He said, why don't you cry a little bit louder? Maybe he's gone on a trip somewhere. Maybe Baal's having a little hard time hearing you. You'll scream out a little louder. You might just get his attention. And louder they screamed. And they tried everything. And Elijah was just having a blast. And maybe he's on vacation. Maybe something's gone wrong. He's got his attention. He knew there was only one God that answered by fire. He knew that his God was the only consuming fire that there was. And so when it came Elijah's turn, Elijah laid it all out, laid the sacrifice, and said, wait, before I pray, I want you to bring 12 barrels of water. What do you want the water for? He said, I'm going to show you how hot his fire is. I'm going to show you how powerful it is. And they dumped the 12 barrels of water, and Elijah fixed a trench all the way around, you know, kind of like the alligator moat that they do to make sure that there's water. You can't get to it without having to go through the water. And he fixed a trench around it to where it's soaking wet wood. I tried burning some soaking wet wood this week. Some of you may have too. Amen. Found out, oh Lord, it's hard to burn wood that's soaking wet, that's been sitting out in the rain, that you didn't get under the cover. But he drenched it on down. He soaked the wood. He soaked the sacrifice that was there. He let water fill the trenches that were all around. He said, are you ready? Are you ready for God to show you who is the God of fire? And there he prayed a simple prayer unto the Lord. And when he got done praying, the Bible said that fire fell from heaven. Hallelujah. It not only consumed the sacrifice, it burned up all the wood, and the scripture said it lapped up all the water that was in the trench round about on top of Mount Carmel. And Elijah, amen, stood up saying, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. We've got the only God that answers by fire. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you, friend, if you're not convinced, you need to get convinced tonight that a one God apostolic church is the only place where a soul can go to feel the real fire. They can get entertained. Amen. They can feel a lot of good social things happening in other churches, but there's only one God that answers by fire. And that Holy Ghost fire needs to be valuable to you and I in the house of the Lord. But I'm here to tell you something tonight, and that is that in all of the scriptural fires that you read about in the Bible, God never provided the wood. Hallelujah. He said, believe me, I can produce the fire, but I ain't toting the wood for none of you. I'm not doing it. If you want the fire bad enough, getting the wood there is your job. It's your job. It's your responsibility. It's what you have to do in preparation for the fire of God that's going to burn and provide the thing. God provides the fire only after we provide the wood. Genesis chapter 22 illustrates that story, that Abraham was instructed by God, I want you to go to Mount Moriah, and there you're going to offer a burnt offering, a sacrifice unto the Lord. And the Bible said in verse number 3, that old Abraham woke up early. He saddled up his donkey, and the King James Version of the Word says, and he clave the wood. Or in everyday English, he got out the axe and he chopped the wood. What are you doing, Abraham? What are you doing? I'm getting prepared for the place that God has called me to go, because God wants a burnt offering, a sacrifice to be offered there. And my duty and my responsibility is I got to get the fire. I got to get the wood there. And God's going to answer by fire. But I got to load it up. I got to chop it up. I got to get it ready. I got to transport it there. I got to get it to the altar. I got to do all of my duties and my responsibility for the glory of the Lord. I preach to you tonight, amen, that prayer meetings are supposed to be a spiritual bonfire where the good, obedient saints of God are bringing the firewood to add to the bonfire of God's blessing and God's fire. Hallelujah. It's always been that way in the Scripture. I hope to show you a part of it. But it's not by accident that the book of Acts begins, amen. It begins and the book of Acts ends with a group bonfire. Hallelujah. It begins. Everything about the Acts of the Apostles is covered by a group bonfire. Amen. There at the beginning on the day of Pentecost. And when the last chapter is finally written in a small little island out there called Melita, you've got the Apostle Paul participating in a group bonfire. You've got the apostles showing us the example of what it's all about, how we pitch in together for the fire that God wants to send unto us. Amen. Last year, as I felt so heavily, amen, by the Lord, I preached back many months ago, two Sunday nights in a row, on the subject of an apostolic prayer meeting. Now, you might not remember it, and I don't think that everything I preach is memorable. Amen. But I'm reminding you of that. I preached two Sunday nights in a row on an apostolic prayer meeting. Amen. About how the place was shaken where they were assembled together in prayer. And what God did when they came for that group bonfire. And they got to doing what they were supposed to be doing in the prayer meeting that was there. But the significant part of those two messages that I want to remind you of tonight is we dealt with the fact that the Bible said, amen, that the early church, this prayer meeting that resulted in the place being shaken was because they lifted up their voices. They lifted up their voices. They didn't just walk around and mumble words. They didn't just kneel at their seats and bury their heads and keep readjusting their skirts. And watching their watches to say, "Oh Lord, when are the lights coming back up?" Oh, hallelujah. Apostolic prayer meetings that happened in the book of Acts was when every participant of the bonfire lifted up their voices. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. They lifted up their voices in prayer. Amen. I might talk normally at this decibel level that's here, but when I'm building a bonfire of an apostolic prayer meeting, it's a totally different level that the decibels of my voice are at. That's the way it was in Scripture. They lifted up their voices. They got into the prayer meeting. They got into it. And I showed you an example in the Bible, if you will recall, or let me refresh your memory, that the only other place that those same words are used, that they lifted up their voice, was what a leper, someone that had the disease of leprosy, when they cried out, "Unclean, stay back, stay back, unclean, I've got leprosy, stay back." They weren't allowed to say, "Unclean, unclean, I've got leprosy, stay back, I'm unclean." They weren't allowed to do that because, according to Mosaic law, they had to keep people at least, we talked about, amen, people at least the distance of being across the street. Amen. And I preached about that if you're participating in an apostolic prayer meeting, your voice, not the voice of who's got the leather lungs of the church, but your voice has to be lifted up, or should be lifted up high enough to where if you were standing on this side of Victory Boulevard, you're talking loud enough so somebody on the other side of Victory Boulevard could hear what you're saying. Oh, hallelujah. So having an apostolic prayer meeting, building an apostolic bonfire, it's not a yelling, shouting match to see who can get the loudest. And I can get my voice up above her voice or up above his voice. It's just everybody saying that, amen, I'm willing to get into this prayer meeting emotionally enough that I'm not talking down on the lower levels, that I'm talking loud enough to be heard around across the street, saying, "God, we need help around here. God, we need your fire around here. God, we need your power around here. God, we've got some of our sons that are bound by drugs and they need delivered. We got some of our daughters that are getting involved in immorality and they need the chains broken, God. We need your fire. We need you to do miracles for us. We got homes that might end up in divorce. Amen. If we don't have the kind of church service that we're supposed to have. Oh, God, we need you. We need your power. We need your glory." That's the kind of fire building. Oh, hallelujah. That the New Testament Apostolic Church participated in. I'm sorry, I don't care what your family custom is. I don't care how most of you were taught in the Catholic Church. And I'm telling you, we ain't nothing like the Catholic Church. There's nothing acceptable about you kneeling down when we're supposed to be having a prayer meeting and acting like you're still in the Catholic Church. There's nothing about that that is pleasing to God. When you became a one God apostolic, you're supposed to not only dress like Him, you're supposed to start praying like Him. Amen. You're supposed to start lifting up your voice. You're supposed to start crying out to God. You're supposed to start helping build the fire. We've got to get a fire going in Victory Tabernacle every time we get together. And we need teamwork. We need teamwork. We need your help. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Now I'm going to ask you a question. Amen. And I hope, if you forget everything else I said tonight, I hope this question follows you home. All the way home. When you join in the prayer meeting, that means when you walk through the doors. When you, as an individual, join in the prayer meeting, does it make a noticeable difference as to how hot the fire is? Huh? So when you walk in the door, not when the evangelist walks in the door, not when Pastor White walks in the door, but when you walk in the door, hallelujah, does the contribution of firewood that you're carrying with you, does it make a noticeable difference? Whew, business is picking up around here. Whew, this fire was just a little old fire just a minute ago, but somebody walked in, amen, to the building that brought a load of lumber with them. Somebody walked in that brought some firewood with them. I'm asking you the question, can you walk into a prayer meeting and nobody else even know that you came? Nobody else even noticed. Oh, yeah, that family walked in the door. I wouldn't have even known they were here until the lights came on. I wouldn't have even known they were a part of this prayer meeting. Can I talk to you, brother? Can I talk to you, sister? Amen. You are supposed to bring your own noticeable contribution to the bonfire when you come. Hallelujah. You're not just to come and pull up to the fire and roast a few marshmallows. Oh, hallelujah. And have you a few graham crackers with chocolate on it and say, whoa, I like the fire. If you're going to warm by the fire, you're supposed to bring some firewood with you. Everybody in the place is supposed to say, thank God she got here. Thank God he got here. Thank God that family walked in. Thank God that brother came. We're getting the fire going around here. They're adding to it. They're adding to it. They're blessing the prayer meeting. I can feel it. Can you feel it? Feel what they're contributing. Feel what they're adding to the fire. Feel what's going on. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I'm telling you, teamwork is needed in all prayer meetings at Victory Tabernacle. We need more than your body,
sickness at you. We need more, amen, than your body walking around these aisles. We need more than just your presence being here. We need you getting a hold of some firewood and saying, I brought a contribution to this prayer meeting tonight. I don't care what anybody else does. I brought some wood. God supplies the fire, but we supply the wood. We bring it. We get it bigger and bigger and bigger.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was 25 years of age when I came to my first bonfire at Victory Tabernacle. I was 25. And I came, and I remember thinking to myself, well, this is a little unfair that I have to carry a disproportionate amount of weight in this prayer meeting. But I'm 25, and I'm strong enough, and I'm going to do it. I'll carry it if nobody else is going to add to the prayer meeting. And I prayed with all of my strength, with all of my with everything within me. I prayed as a 25-year-old is supposed to be able to pray. Paul said, I write unto you young men because you're strong. You're strong. He wasn't just talking about bench pressing. He was saying, you got the strength. Get in there and make it happen. You got the strength. Get in there and make it happen. Oh, God. Amen. I remember that feeling. And I thought to myself, amen. I wasn't the pastor yet of this church. But I thought to myself, if I become the pastor, I'm going to do my best to try to teach the people that it's unfair to let the pastor carry a disproportionate amount of the weight of a prayer meeting. It's unfair to let his voice be the dominant voice during a prayer meeting. It's unfair for everybody to warm by the same fire, but nobody to get involved in teamwork in building the fire and making it up in their mind that this is my church. These are my kids. Amen. This is my marriage that's at stake. And I've got to make sure there's plenty of firewood on this fire. I've got to make sure, amen, we don't have a ho-hum service, that we have the power of God moving in our midst. Oh, hallelujah. And here it is almost 30 years later. And for the life of me, I can't figure out how some of you in good conscience could warm by the fire, service after service, when you walk into the prayer meeting, you make no noticeable difference in the amount of heat that's coming from that fire. You are a spiritual freeloader if you do that. I said it. You better believe I said it. You are man, woman, teenager. You're a spiritual freeloader if you warm by the fire, but you won't help bring the firewood in and get the blaze going. If you won't add your heart and your emotions and your strength to the prayer meeting, and said, I've got to do my part. I've got to do my part. I've got to do my part. I ain't going to let anybody carry a disproportionate amount of this. I'm going to do my part. I'm going to get the prayer meeting going. I'm going to get the fire of God burning. The Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. A pastor. Hear me. Hallelujah. The Lord might not have returned before I pass from this life. And I preach not just for myself, but I preach for any and every church you ever go to in your life. A pastor should never have to carry a prayer meeting alone. Should never, never have to be the only one that brings sizable logs to the bonfire. And everybody else gets by with throwing a stick in every now and then. Making a small little minor. Hallelujah. 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 Brother, it takes teamwork in building a fire. It takes teamwork. It takes everybody. 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 You know, and I love, and I honestly, earnestly hope I'm not misunderstood. I love the branch pastors that have been sent out from this church. But woe when I go to be there. I hear them with the way they're praying, with the burden of that fire before service. And I think to myself, how much hotter the fire would have burned at Burbank if they would have learned how to do that before they became a pastor. If they would have learned how to be a major contributor to the bonfire before they had to carry the load by themselves. And I'm preaching to every last one of you, every minister that's a part of this church. It's the will of God that you learn how to carry, amen, a major part of a bonfire a long time before you have the title of a pastor. It's the will of God that every young person in this church, amen, some of you have told me, you've told me of desires within your heart to one day be a preacher, to one day be a preacher's wife. I'm here to preach to you because I love you. If God's ever got designs for you to ever be a preacher's wife, He's looking right now before you're a preacher's wife. And He's seeing how much wood do they bring to the fire? How much wood do they bring to the fire? If God's going to ever use you as a minister, He's looking to see at age 15 when they walk in the doors. Amen. Do they carry a bundle of firewood? They said, I'm here, Pastor. I'm not a preacher yet. Amen. But I know how to do teamwork in building a fire. I know what's needed in an apostolic church. I know. I've got to add my portion. Got to add it to the fire we need. Oh, there are times, I understand, there are times, like it said of Jesus, that He tread the winepress alone. Now, there are certain things that a pastor has to do by himself. Amen. I want you to know I understand. There are certain things you can't do. There are certain jobs and responsibilities. When I'm here dealing with a difficult problem, I've never called one of you when it's midnight. I'm here, still here in the office trying to help somebody. Save their marriage. Save their home. We don't have a little hotline. We push buttons and say, wake up, saints, wake up, wake up. Pastor needs you to help pray right now. Wake up, wake up, wake up. You're not disturbed. I know there are jobs that I have to tread the winepress alone. I understand that. I do it without complaining. You've never heard me, Christ. I do it as a devotion unto God. There are things to do and times that you just need. You just need, and God expects me to do it. And I do it. I go over homes. And I meet with people at hours of the night. And I go and I visit. And I do everything I can possibly do. I tread the wine press alone sometimes. I'm not soliciting a pity party. But I thought, you know, it'd do me good sometime to tell some of these saints some of the stories. The pastor treading the wine press alone. It might get a little more of a burden and an understanding that when it comes to building bonfires when we can help, how much more willing we ought to be to help them. I looked at my wife. It was West Coast Conference. And it was just moments before I was leaving the motel room to have to go and preach that night. And I look on my phone, and a text message comes. That's a suicide note. And I looked at the text message in the motel room. And I thought, oh God, this is so unfair. This is so unfair. This person knows that I'm fixing to go and preach in this service. But now I'm torn, not knowing if the family needs my help or not. Not knowing if I should call up Elder Morton and say, I'm sorry. I gotta get in my car and get back to Burbank. Gotta desperate. Not knowing if the suicide is done or not done. Not knowing anything. And I told my wife, I said, honey, let's pray. I need some direction from God. I need to know what to do. I need to know if I should even preach tonight or what I should do. I can't preach to the audience if my heart's divided and I'm all in a fret, worrying about something. We prayed there together. God would give me some peace to know exactly what to do. And I did what I felt like God talked to me to do. There's times the pastor treads the wine press alone. You're not there. You're not expected to be there. It's alone. Christmas Day, I woke up to a text message. And not a Merry Christmas text message. But I woke up to a text message. It was on my phone. From another individual in our church, who's been a part of our church. Amen. Saying, I will be leaving Victory Tabernacle. Jesus was not born on December 25th. What a wonderful Merry Christmas. What a wonderful way to treat your pastor. I thought, July 4th wasn't the day they signed the Declaration of Independence either. But there was a July 4th. There was a day of independence, and Jesus really was born, whether you believe it or not. He really, really was. There was a day that he was born. Yeah. El Pastor treads the wine press alone. You don't hear any griping. You don't hear any moaning. When people tell me all their gripes and say goodbye, I'm gone. I'm out of here. I do what God's called me to do. And I try to do it with dignity and with a burden and with respect. But God never asks a pastor to carry prayer meetings alone. God never expected a pastor to try to build bonfires all by himself. He expects every child of God to be a major contributor. And you walk in the door and everybody in the house feel the temperature rise. Everybody feel that, amen, a little warmer in the spirit. Because here came somebody that really knows how to pray. Here comes somebody that really knows how to touch God. They ain't going to be messing around. They're going to be praying. They're going to be getting a hold of God. They're going to see God doing great things. Hallelujah. Brother Mike Emery was over at my house doing some work for me, and I told him he gave me an inspiration. Amen. One day, he was there, and he had his brother-in-law with him, and he was helping us to pour, to get out of the mud over there on the side, a little bit of concrete, and I was over there trying to do my part with some stakes and do some stuff. And he said, hey, wait a minute, pastor. And he called his brother-in-law over there who was helping out for the day. And he said, he's going to do that. I said, well, I'm going to help out. I'm going to do it. He said, no. He said, I learned a long time ago, you never let the boss outwork you. Whoo, hallelujah. I learned a long time ago, you never let the boss outwork you. Ooh, hallelujah. What would happen to Victory Tabernacle in 2010? Amen. Hallelujah. If the good saints of God got a revelation that we ain't never gonna let the pastor outpray us in an altar service. We ain't never gonna let him outpray us in a prayer meeting. If he wants to contribute, he can. But it's our turn. It's our turn. It's our turn. It's our turn to make our contribution. It's our turn to get the fire going. It's our turn. Oh, hallelujah. The Apostle Paul was an old man, and I'm asking the musicians to come. He was at least 70 and probably much older. And there was a boatload of younger criminals that were on that same boat. Read about it, Acts chapter 28. Criminals didn't live long back in those days. They put them to death real quick. They didn't have the old prisoners that we do in our prison systems that won't put anybody to death. Nero's chopping block was chopping off heads as quick as they could get the boatloads there. And they knew that. And here was a boatload of younger criminals, and the one old man is on that boat when he shipwrecks off the island of Melita. It's an old man named Paul. The scripture said that when they came to the island soaking wet, they had to swim to shore. The rain, the Bible said, the cold, they swam to shore. Brother, arthritis starts talking to you when you're in your 70s. It's painful and hard to even walk, much less swim out there in the water and make your way to shore. And when he got to shore, the Bible says, there's a whole bunch of native folks that are saying, we want to be hospitable to these guys. And the Bible said the natives, the barbarians, kindled the fire. They said, come on. Hey, old timer. Hey, come on up to this fire. Come on up to this fire. There's Paul soaking wet. The fire's already going. But somewhere, the principles that Paul lived by kicked in. He said, But there's a whole lot of young bucks. But I ain't going to warm by a fire that I don't help build. You're going to do it. Oh, hop along, Cassidy. Get up from that fire. Start rummaging around for some firewood. Oh, hallelujah. He's too old to carry logs now. He used to could carry logs to the fire. Bring the logs and drag them in. Strong, muscular young man. He used to could carry logs, but he's reduced down to the stage that all he can do is pick up sticks now. But did you notice? He didn't just find one, two, three sticks. The old timer decided, if I'm going to warm by that fire, if I can't carry logs anymore, at least I'm going to get as big of a bundle of sticks as what I can walk with. And over to the fire goes Paul with a big bundle of sticks. Paul, hallelujah, not thinking that somebody else carry the load. He goes with his friend. Little does he know that there's a poisonous snake that's hibernating on that cold bundle of sticks. And he's in the middle. That's why I know it was a big bundle, because he couldn't even see the snake that was in it. As far as his arms can stretch around it, the old man comes back to the fire. He comes and gets as close as he can. He dumps all that he could possibly carry into that bonfire for everybody's benefit. And that snake wakes up. And that snake says, "Woo, Chihuahua. Wake up. Winter's over, brother. Summertime has come." And that snake reaches out and grabs a hold of Paul's hand as Paul's trying to push the rest of it into the fire. Wow. What a man. What an example. I've become an official senior citizen this year. And so to all of you that are older than me, I say, when we no longer can carry logs, we still better carry as big of a bundle of sticks as what we can wrap our arms around. And not sit on a prayer meeting like a bad example to the rest of the young ones. When our knees and our joints and our aches and our pains won't let us walk anymore, run anymore, we can still sit there and pray with a hot heart. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Would you move tonight, God? Would you move tonight, Lord? Oh, hallelujah. If your heart's in it, when you walk into the prayer meeting, everybody feels business start picking up. Everybody feel, there's a prayerful woman that just walked in. All I was hearing was the voices of men until she walked in. I don't know who she is, but a prayerful woman just walked in to this prayer meeting, and she's bringing her firewood with her. And whoa, can you feel it? Can you feel it, saints? Can you feel it? Amen. Somebody spiritual, somebody prayerful, somebody just walked in, and you start feeling the difference of the prayers that are there. I'm praying for preaching to you. I'm preaching to you. Pastor friend of mine, and I close, I know I'm long-winded tonight. I called him this week. He's my age. He thought he was as young as he used to be. He thought he was as strong as he used to be. He was up on a platform trying to help, amen, remove a heavy auto part, and he thought he could carry like he used to could carry. And when the weight of that dropped down, it flipped him off of the platform, knocked him completely out. He obviously put his arm out to try to break his fall so he didn't break his neck, but he broke his arm. I called him when he was coming from the hospital to go home. He was telling me the story. And I thought, my dear brother, I know we all think, I wished I could tell you. I really wished I could tell you. I could still carry logs. And I didn't need your help. But I'd be lying. I can't carry what I used to could carry. I can't lift what I used to could lift. I'll get hurt trying. I'll get hurt trying. I need your help in building bonfires in every prayer meeting. I need every man, every woman, every teenager, every last one of you to learn how to make a significant contribution to every prayer meeting we have at Victory Tabernacle. Stand together. Hallelujah. Let's come gather up around this altar. Let's come seek the face of God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh.